Hi, I am Sandy Melanio Rivero, born and raised in Caracas, Venezuela. I came here in 1969, 47 years ago, to the city of New York, from Venezuela, Caracas, Venezuela. And I decided to come to the United States to study English. I went to school, and they handled more than one hat in the job. Work in the banking industry, and I work for the government of the United States, the city of New York, especially to the area of Jersey. I started to work in 1971. It has been a real pleasure for me because after 47 years in this country, I just not only benefit from the opportunity that this country gives you, but the opportunity to have a beautiful experience. In 1971, I married my beautiful wife, Millicent Rivero. We have a fantastic and beautiful life. So far, we're going to celebrate next November our 45th anniversary. My life in the United States has been very successful and very pleasant. I had the opportunity to see the world, to learn a lot of languages, and writing a book, The Man I Became. It's an autobiography. I am actually a Spanish tutor, which is a second experience, a second career in my life. So far, I am a retiree. I'm enjoying my retiree life.
I came here in 1969 as a student, not speaking one single word of English. I'm trying my way to become a student, okay? But when I came here, it was the biggest snowstorm in New York. It was in February 9th. So we couldn't be landing in Kennedy Airport. They took us to Canada. We had to stay in Canada for two full cold days. Then we had to come back from Canada by bus. And when I was looking at this white ocean through the road, and it was such an experience. Say, my God, such a beautiful experience. But the problem, I couldn't even share with anybody. It was very depressing. But you know, with this, I have my spirit to say, I have to overcome all these problems with the language. And that was my main concern in coming to America. I came to Jersey looking for a job, but I didn't know anything about Jersey, you know, or village or whatever. So what happened? It happened to be going to a liquor store and asked for a job, and I was hired to be a delivery boy. And I started to work at delivering the liquors all over the neighborhood. I spent about close to 2 years working in the liquor store. After that time, my wife, who I met during the time working in the liquor store, we decided to get married, and my ex-boss recommended me to be working in the field that he knew that I had gone to school in Venezuela in accounting. So I went to work in Chicago Corporation, and they really liked my services. You see, I was promoted to be a supervisor in those Chicago Corporation. And to me, that was really an excitement because now I'm dealing with the public. They're gonna make me to improve my communication in the English languages, which is one of my purposes of having coming to this country. So I worked with the corporation, and they promoted me, and then it came to a time that I reached what they call the upper step of the ladder. So I decided to, for some reason, to leave that job and go into the banking industry, which I really went to, because that's what I graduated in accounting. So I've been working, went to work for the Marine Midland Bank as an accountant translator. And I spent almost 2 years in the bank, and then I married a beautiful lady who spent 40 years in the airline field. She was working at the airport. You have to understand that I am in the 70s, early 70s. They still you find a little, what they call, bias. But we call them, what a tree you find also. I don't want to use the heavy word, but you know, discrimination. So, but anyway, I decided to go and looking for a job in different fields. So I had the opportunity to go to the city of New York, and I got a job in the budget department. I was assigned to be a senior auditor of accounts. I started as a senior auditor of accounts, and I worked then for the last 16 years of my life in the labor force. After that, in 2000, I decided to retire from the labor force and enjoy my life because I married a beautiful lady who spent 40 years in the airline field. She used to work in Kennedy Airport. And we used to travel all over. Of course, with the benefit of being free traveling, I have a beautiful experience of traveling, going around the globe twice. And I had the opportunity to speak not only English, to learn other languages. And I had such an inspiration of learning languages that I became very introverted to talk to people. And, you know, having the opportunity in New York City, which is full of everybody. People say it's a, you know, like a melting pot, but I don't think it's a melting pot. I would say it's a salad bowl where everybody is there, but nobody mixed. Okay. After so many years of being in the United States and enjoy life and traveling, I happened to be, because I have been in Asia in several occasions, I was in China. And visiting China, we visited one of the real poor neighborhoods, very bad, what they call the minority group. And when we were walking through the street, no paved street, dirt road, dirty oxen work, I told my cousin, my goodness, La Cañada de la Iglesia. La Cañada de la Iglesia happened to be the ghetto where I was born and raised in Caracas. No school, up to the age, when I was 21 years old, that was the time when I first set foot in a school. And when I talked to my cousin, she couldn't believe me. She said, she was married to a cousin, my friend. So she said, I don't believe that you come with such a basic question. You have to write a book about yourself. You have to write a book about your life. So she lives in Caracas, I live in New York, and from time to time we used to talk on the phone, and she used to tell me, what is the book? Why you want to write the book? You told me about that beautiful life experience. So I started to write the book, and my goodness, I feel very happy, because the name of my book is The Man I Became. And this is an autobiography of, the name is Sandy Melanie Rivero, the autobiography of a Venezuelan immigrant in New York City. And did you read this book? I mean, my friends in China, in Europe, and all over the world, they have told me it was such a beautiful job. It's an inspiration for anybody that I should have written in Spanish. But I said, well, Spanish is a language spoken as a second language in New York. But not too many people read. So what happened? I wrote the book in Spanish too. But I have to send it. Well, it's a translation. The translation of the title. El hombre que he llegado a ser. And by coincidence, in 2007, I began teaching Spanish. And now I have become a tutor in Spanish. And most of my students are professional people, doctor, PhD, lawyer. And I couldn't believe a man who never went to school up to the age of 21 now becomes an instructor in more than one language in New York City. My first language that I learned in Venezuela was Italian, then Portuguese. Coming to America to learn English, then I found Greek. I said, oh my goodness, Greek? So I learned Greek. We're traveling, I learned French, German, and with the experience of being in New York City with everybody, I can communicate, I would say 10 languages. I had the opportunity to study about 14 or 15 languages, but I cannot say that I'm fluent in them, but I can communicate. Well, because of my experience in New York City, I'm thinking where I'm coming from, my goodness, I start thinking, this is amazing. From where I'm coming from, the ghetto of Caracas, up to the big city of New York, and being where I am now. That inspired me to continue living in the city. And I became an American citizen, by the way. But I always tell people, if I would have, in the 60s, met Hugo Chavez, who was a president of Venezuela, probably I wouldn't have the opportunity to come to New York, because in those times, The university gate were too heavy to be open to the poor and blacks. And they said, well, here in my own country, I can't even go to school. And if I wanted to go to university, that was a real, real tough time. So I decided to come to New York, and that's what I admire about Hugo Chavez, because he, when he took over the power of the government of Venezuela, he gave the free school to every single citizen. He created a program to teach the old people, which the percentage of illiterate in Venezuela was extremely high. Because over there, when you get 20 years old and you only know how to say your name and write it, that's enough for you. And that was the sociology of the Venezuelan. But I'm not trying to say that I'm going to start to talk about politics. But I don't forget life. This is my experience in America. Yes, I went back to Venezuela on different occasions, had property, my car down there. Now I was living, I wouldn't say a splash life, but I was living comfortable in an area with the upper class, with a car. Going to Venezuela, spend 2 months every year for the winter time, taking my car and flying all over, because I'm very curious about the weather. And before I came to Venezuela, before I came to the US, I went all over Venezuela driving. I drove to Colombia twice, because I wanted to have a good image when I set foot in the United States. And they asked me, where are you from? They're from Venezuela. What is Venezuela? So I wanted to explain the socio-economical system of the country, the geography, history, because I love the history. It's not taught very well in the United States. And the reason I'm telling you this, because my experience about teaching the English and the Spanish language here, I found that the people professional, my goodness, they say, well, Sandy, how do you remember this? How do you know it? We never got this in school. And they say, but to me, that was basic. But you see, beside that, I became a self-taught person. This is the reason why people say, how do you speak this language? Because I'm a self-taught person. I learned an expression, and you better believe, the moment that I hear it, I write it down, write it 20 times, and I repeat it like a parrot in my house. My wife knows me, and she said, well, you know, you have a flair for languages. No, a flair. They have the great opportunity in this country to speak so many languages. And I feel very happy. Chelsea is an area which you find people from all over. So I walk around, I speak Russian, I speak Greek, I speak Arabic, I speak Bangladesh, Spanish, English. Oh my God. In one day time, I speak about 6 languages every day. So it's exciting, New York City. I love it. Bueno, Jimmy, sinceramente, de Hugo Chávez te puedo decir muchas cosas, pero vamos a tratar de hacerlo muy breve y también viéndolo a un punto histórico en la historia de Venezuela. Por un ejemplo, algo muy común que la historia de Venezuela muestra bajo un método establecido desde 1498, cuando las invasiones colonialistas de España, Imperial, Inglaterra y Portugal, es el sistema político, social y cultural bajo la mezcla de razas entre indios, negros y blancos, pero controlado y dominado por un pequeño grupo de blancos que constituyen la oligarquía venezolana. Dime, la oligarquía venezolana, que tradicionalmente ha mantenido el sentimiento de que los negros, indios y pobres campesinos no deben ser marginados y explotados, y en muchos casos privados de una educación escolástica. Te puedo decir que un pueblo, claro, un pueblo analfabeta es muy fácil dominarlo. Sin embargo, en la vida todo toca su fin, Jimmy. Para mi concepto, esto fue un factor que instó a Hugo Chávez crear en el 1999 la Revolución Bolivariana para darles a los excluidos la oportunidad de una educación básica y escolástica, la oportunidad de la educación escolástica y conocimiento de sus derechos humanos para que no sigan explotados y que puedan deshacerse del vasallaje. ¿Qué te podemos explicar? Es lo siguiente. Cuando el hombre se deshace del vasallaje, desarrolla una vida digna para el disfrute de sus derechos constitucionales de cada ciudadano. La Constitución, es decir, Hugo Chávez estableció lo que llaman la Constitución de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. Esta reformación por el expresidente Hugo Chávez garantizó al pueblo venezolano de recibir educación gratuita mediante un plan de misiones representada por las siguientes misiones. La misión Robinson, de eliminar el analfabetismo. Este analfabetismo en Venezuela tenía un índice muy alto. Segundo, la misión Riva, que fue una educación para la educación media, lo que llamamos bachillerato. Y la tercera es la misión Sucre. Para mí, digo, excluir a los excluidos a la educación superior. Aparte de todo, Jimmy, el presidente Hugo Chávez fundó un excelente programa socioeconómico que garantiza al pueblo marginado el derecho a la vivienda adecuada para mejorar la vida, el trabajo, la cultura, la educación y la justicia social con beneficios indivisibles de los derechos humanos. Eso es lo que yo te puedo explicar de Hugo Chávez. Claro, lamentándolo bastante, nosotros siempre, en el caso mío, yo siempre deseaba que se mantuviera más en el poder, porque el pueblo se estaba beneficiando bastante y de un punto de cualquier vista. Pero ¿qué pasa? Según como dicen los comentarios, que él fue envenenado por el imperio norteamericano. Y tú sabes cómo pasan todos los lugares. Los presidentes que benefician a un pueblo, el imperio no está de acuerdo. Eso es lo que te puedo explicar de Hugo Chávez, Jimmy.